restart with a little quiz displayed here. And the majority says C, which is the correct answer. So it's a bit counterintuitive in some sense. So the difficulty of cryptography is that when we start talking last week of one thing, it seems relatively trivial, at least if we don't dive into the details on how to prove that AES CBC is secure. That seems fairly trivial. But the difficulty of cryptography is there are many systems and many terms that look similar, but they are subtly different. So here, public cryptography is not the same as private cryptography in the sense that to encrypt or to make something secret, we use a public key. A public key that is not even ours. So that seems a bit, how can I make something secret by using only public things? But that's the key thing. So in order to decrypt the message, we want that only the owner of the private key can decrypt it. This is how we make it secret. Anybody who doesn't have the private key cannot do anything with this message. So we need to have a public key that is matched to the private key of the recipient. The recipient is the PDC, so we have to use the public key of the PDC, which is answer C. Assume we are a well-managed utility, so utility of the future. I don't think many utilities use encryption and authentication in their internal operation inside substations. But if they would, they have N devices and they want them to communicate securely with each other. How many keys do they need to distribute? Close the poll in a few seconds. We have a large variance, but the mode of the distribution is the correct answer. The correct answer is F. Here I'm assuming, which is a bit contorted, I admit, that every device wants to communicate with every device, which is in practice not the case. You probably have servers or concentrators that you communicate with. But if, for the purpose of this exercise, if every device wants to communicate with every device. If we use asymmetric cryptography, what we need is every device to have a public and private key pair, a single key pair, And then anyone else, any other device, needs to know their public key. Right, so we need two keys, one key pair per device. If there are n devices, we have order n keys to distribute. In contrast, if we use asymmetric cryptography, that's for asymmetric. If we use symmetric cryptography, then we use that every pair of communicating devices, there are n times n minus 1 over 2 such pairs, order of n squared. Therefore, you need each of those pairs to have their own private, and not private, I should not say private, their own secret key. And all of those secret keys have to be truly secret, in particular, all different. So we'll need order of n squared. This would be the correct answer if we have a more centralized communication, if we have all the devices communicating with one or a small number of servers, then the number of public-private key pairs we need is one per server, whereas here we would need one key per communicating device. So in any case, we have an order n gain in the number of keys to be distributed, and that's one of the main advantages of private public key systems. Not the only one, as we will see, it has other functions. We saw how to use asymmetric cryptography to provide confidentiality. It can be used in a dual way to provide authenticity. In that context, it is called a signature scheme or digital signature scheme as opposed to handwritten signature, which is not using computer means. So how does a signature scheme work? Well, very similar to a MAC scheme, except again, the keys are, one of the key is private, the other is public. And now the key that is private is the key of the signer. So if you have a message to sign, to authenticate, you take the message, you apply this crypto system with your own private key, and then you send the message in the clear, unless you want to encrypt it using other mechanisms, and you sign it. So you send the message and the signature. For some reason, we use tag when it's symmetric cryptography and signature when it's asymmetric cryptography. And the verification now is not the same, of course, because the verification will use a technique such that by knowing only the public key, I can recompute the signature, or at least verify that the signature does correspond to M here. So this is again magical. It's like asymmetric encryption. There must be somewhere behind that a one-way function, such that there is unforgeability. If you do not know the private key here, it's impossible to forge a signature for a given message. And anybody who has the public key can verify it. So that's a significant difference compared to a MAC scheme, because here anybody can verify it. By allowing somebody to verify, you're not sharing a secret with that other party, which is now fundamentally different. That's what you would like. You would like that anybody is able to verify that something has been correctly sent by the originator who pretends to be the originator, but you don't want to trust and give keys to anybody. So that provides authenticity and integrity like the MAC, but as we will see, it provides a bit more. It can be used to provide non-repudiation and verification that we'll discuss a bit later. Non-repudiation means not just that I am sending the message and this message cannot have been tampered with by someone else, but also I cannot deny that I sent the message. The idea is very simple, because the private key is private. In a public, in a symmetric crypto system used for MAC, the key is used by, the same key is used by the verifier and the signer. So when a message is signed, the verifier says, oh, it's been signed by you, but you can say, no, it was not signed by me, you forged this message. So if you go to court because you pretend I never sent this message, you have two entities that could have created the message, so it's impossible to know who created it. Here, only one entity could create it, so you cannot repudiate the message. You can say, I sent you are stupid, but no, it's not true, I never sent that, or I never employed my wife for a job in the parliament, and you cannot claim that you did not do that. So that's called non-repudiation. We'll talk about public verification in a second, but we see that there is already, something very easy to understand. Anybody here who knows the public key, and the public key by definition is public, so it can be posted on a website, so anybody can verify. How does it work? Well, it can work if we use RSA, it comes for free. RSA has the property that decryption and encryption commute. So this little circle means the composition of operations. So D circle E means if I first encrypt a message, then I decrypt it, of course I obtain the clear text, right? That's the normal use of RSA. But it turns out if you do it the other way around, if you first use the decryption operation with a private key, which consists in taking the message that you have received. So the normal use of RSA is you encrypt by computing m to the power e, modulo k. E is public, k is public. And in order to decrypt, you compute this to the power f, where f is the secret exponent. Now, m to the power e to the power f is the same as m to the power f to the power e, right? It's m to the power e times f. This is true for real numbers. It continues to be true if we do operations modulo some integer here. So what are we doing is if we do this, then I apply to a message m that normally was intended to be a ciphertext, that should be the C here, but if I apply it to a plain text here, I obtain m to the power f. I am therefore using the decryption operation. Then anybody who knows the public key, anybody who knows the public exponent and the modulo k, can do this, mf to the power e, and will obtain m, the clear text m here. So this is used in RSA. How do you do an RSA digital signature scheme? Well, you take your message, you compute m to the power f. Now, only you can know the little exponent f. And you transmit this. This is your signature. You transmit it along with the message. Then anybody who knows the public key, capital K, and the exponent E, which is a constant of the system and is well known, can verify by applying this operation, the signature to the power E should be equal to the message I have received. So this is not M prime, sorry, this is S prime. So the signature S prime here should be equal to the signature S here. And as we have shown, if RSA is secure, which occurs in practice if you have a capital K that's large enough, then it is impossible to break this, and in particular, to forge incorrect signatures. So I correct. You compute the S prime of M. So you compute, you receive the message M, you apply the E function that we had before, which is this signature computed to the power E. If this is equal to the signature that has been transmitted along with the message, then it means that the signature is correct. So this is one way of using, in fact, that's the most frequent way in which we use RSA. We use it frequently to compute secret keys for establishing session keys, but also to compute signatures. Now it turns out that, so the operation is very similar to the operation, to how we use a crypto system to provide a MAC. A symmetric crypto system. Here we've used also an analogy, how to use a public key encryption system to provide a signature. The same problems arise. The problem is that we would like to sign something and obtain a signature that is not too long. If I sign a book of 2,000 pages, the signature should not be 2,000 pages. It should be something smaller. So we have to reduce the size. We have seen with Max how we reduce the size. For example, if we use a block cipher like AES, we use a chaining mechanism that will produce similar things. Now the block, if we use blocks in RSA, the blocks are of various sizes. So typically we use a different way to manipulate a text and obtain a text of that is of a small block size. And this particular way is called a hash function. So a hash function is one more of the in the zoo of parameters that two crypt systems negotiate to secure system negotiates. They negotiate what kind of symmetric encryption they will use, what kind of MAC they will use, what kind of asymmetric encryption they will use. You will also find in the list of parameters to be negotiated a hash function. A hash function is something quite general that is used, for example, in Python programming when you have things like hash data structures. When a hash function, the principle originates from programming, the idea is that a hash function maps a message that is very long into a block that is very short and appears to be random, such that if you change one or two little things in the original message, the hash value will be completely different. The hash value in this context is called a digest. Right? So the digest must appear to be randomly chosen among all the possible k values, and then we typically use a crypto system by applying it to the digest. So today, if we use RSA or DSA to produce a signature, we will take the long message, we will hash it, obtain a digest that is small, and it's the digest that will be signed. We could use the same approach instead of CBC chaining for the MAC, and this can also be used, but today this is what is typically used with RSA. So I insist that the hash function has a common property with a MAC. A MAC also takes a long message and distills it to a short tag, but here a hash function has no key. There's no secret in a hash function. So a hash function is simply a hashing machinery that is completely deterministic. If you know the input, the output is always the same. The key is in the signature scheme that you apply to after hashing. So long message produce a digest. Here there's no hash, so anybody who has the same M will produce the same D. And what you sign is the digest. So why is that expected to be good? Well, it's expected to be good if the hash function is collision resistant. So let me give an example. So Homer is transferring money to this account. Then we could use as a hash function the same function as we saw before, but now the parameters A and B are made public, so everything is public. We can consider this as a hashing function. It takes a long string of characters that I translate into a string of bits, which itself is translated into a large integer, and by taking modulo with a few obfuscation operations, I have a way of hashing. And it looks that the output here appears to be very random and unrelated to the input. In particular, if I forge the destination bank account, it will be visible because the digest is different. And the digest is what will be signed. So if I receive this with a digest that has been modified, of course, the original digest, which was F7, is the one that was signed. So if I verify the signature, I verify the signature for the digest 74, it will fail because the signature I will receive has been computed with the digest F7. Here I did a little game. I said, can I modify this message such that I obtain the same digest? F7 was the original digest of the original message, F7. So I did the following game. I am giving a message. Can I tamper with the message such that I obtain a given digest which is known in advance, which was the digest I had before tampering with the message? Intuitively, the answer should be no, because my hash function appears to be random. But of course, nothing is random in the computer. Everything is done by an algorithm, so it's completely deterministic. So I simulated randomness with this chaotic operation that takes an input M and does AM plus B modulo some large P here. And to human beings, it appears to be random. But to smart human beings who know a bit of number theory, then it's possible to play with the message. For example, in the message there are spaces. The spaces are necessary, otherwise the message becomes completely unreadable. The spaces are an ASCII character that has its own code. If I insert a number of spaces, I modify the message. So depending on where I insert it, if you insert a space, it's like inserting a digit in a large number. If I give you the number 23 and I add a 5 in the middle, what did I do to the number 23? How do I go from 23 to 253? Well, we can understand that. If I have inserted the 5 in the second position, that means that I have added 5 times 10. I have removed 2 times 10, which is the original 2, and I have added, also I've replaced 20 by 200, so I have added 90 times 2. So I've done a number of mathematical operations on the number by inserting a character. Here, the exercise I did was say, I tried to model this and say, where do I need to insert how many spaces and where do I need to insert them, such that at the end I obtain the ideal number. I did it by brute force, by adding enough spaces from the end until I found a hash that's the same, which happens to be possible here. You need a special combinations of that to happen. But you see, those two messages are radically different. But to human beings, if you're, I mean, first, how do banks work? I mean, first, they don't look at messages, only computers look at them. And if somebody complains because you say, hey, why did my transfer net go through? Then a human being will read it, and the human being will read that and say, oh, we've received your message. It was sent to sender Penelope. Yes, correct. That's what you said. Fine. So the message will be considered correct. What has happened here, of course, the hash function is not collision resistant. It is possible for a smart attacker to transform a message such that the digest has a given digest property. Now, it was the same problem with a Mac. A Mac also had the same potential problem, but since a Mac has a key, it's more difficult to forge something. Now, hash, which is a universal function that has no key, must be collision resistant. It's very difficult to be collision resistant, and there is a long symmetry of dead hash functions that were thought to be collision resistant and are not. So collision resistance, as I say, mean that it should be impossible to forge a message. Of course, it's never impossible because the mapping from the message to the digest is many to one. The digest is smaller than the message. So mathematically, again by the pigeonholes principle, there must be lots of messages that have the same digest. But the crux is it constructively possible to exploit this other than by the brute force approach? And if your digest is large enough, typically several hundreds, 250 or 300 bits, then finding all possible messages will mean trying all of this. Sometimes if you want to exploit the birthday paradox, you might use a smaller number here. I mentioned that there are many cryptographic hash functions that were proven insecure. So MD5, SHA-0 were hash functions that have been in use, that are still in use by many cryptographic systems, and they were shown to be not collision resistant. And we should not be surprised. I mean, it is inherently very difficult to prove that something is collision resistant. So today, SHA-2 and SHA-3, which are hash functions, are assumed to be collision resistant. So when you negotiate your security parameters, when you install your PMU and your PDC, you have to be sure that they do not support MD5 and SHA-0, because if they do, an easy attack would consist in, for example, forcing one of the system to do not support these, but support only those. And since those things can be manipulated, then your crypto system will not be safe, will not be secure. Let's pause for another little quiz. I close the poll now. And the majority is right, so the correct answer is the PMU's public key. So the PDC received the data and wants to verify it. Verification with asymmetric cryptography is using the public key. So we verify, and by verifying this, we have some, with some level of certainty, we can say that it was signed by somebody who owns the PMU private key. Therefore, it can only be the PMU if everything is fine. A more contorted question now. What is this? What do those things mean? So, CBCAES sub K means I'm using a MAC scheme, message authentication code scheme, that uses AES with the CBC form of chaining. So there is AES CBC and CBC AES. So CBCAES is the MAC scheme, not the encryption scheme. HMAC SHA-512 is something similar that that uses private key public key cryptography, but by first using a hash function. So SHA is a hash function. The same trick we use with asymmetric cryptography can use with symmetric cryptography. I can create a MAC by first hashing and then encrypting the hash. So this is the scheme here. And SHA is simply hashing, so there is no key. Sorry, I said something completely wrong. CBCAES is the encryption scheme for confidentiality. So this is the, it's not a MAC scheme. Right? This one is a MAC scheme. AES CBC is the, so this is not a MAC. This is the chaining mode for AES that produces a stream cipher out of a block cipher. So this is the ciphertext, not the tag. C stands for ciphertext. I'm saved by the name of my variables. C is the ciphertext, T is the tag, and D is the digital, is the digest. Okay, I close in a few seconds. You have a last opportunity to win the honor of giving a good answer. I close now. And the correct answer is not very popular, but is A. The encrypted text is a one-to-one mapping of the plain text once we know the key. So if the encrypted texts are encrypted with the same key here, if they are the same, it means the messages were the same. In fact, we will be able to obtain M and M prime from C and C prime. So if they're equal, the same decryption property will give the same. And this is not true for a tag. This is not true for a MAC. There can be a collision by the pigeonhole principle. The message is too small to make sure this never happens. And the same is true for digest. But of course, we believe, if the thing is secure, that it's very hard to forge such things. So if you have two messages that are different, finding tags that are the same is a very difficult problem. Unlike we saw with Homer's tag and hash functions. Questions? So it's important to remember all those differences to be able to understand why a crypto system might be secure or not secure. There is cryptographic encryption. There is a symmetric encryption. There is MAC that uses symmetric encryption as building block and perhaps a hash function or a chaining system. There is asymmetric encryption and asymmetric signature that may use the same mathematics in the case of RSA, for example. And we can use a hash in any case to go from a crypto system to a tag or a signature. Yes? It is collision resistant, but it doesn't mean that it's true. It is collision resistant, but collision resistant is a certification at a given point in time. So it means nobody has found a way to forge collisions. But it does not mean that collisions are impossible.
So when you say what is true, you mean in an absolute sense, not in a...
Yes, yes, yes. I'm an absolutist. But you're right. So in practice, it's true. If you see this, it means either that, there can be structural reasons. It can be that the message is the same. But if the message is not the same, it can be by accident, which is not impossible. I mean, given the number of messages sent, sooner or later it will happen. But most likely it means the attacker has, I mean, SHA is no longer safe, no longer secure, which might happen one day. I mean, MD5 was believed to be secure. If I would teach that 15 years ago, I would put MD5 in the list of collision-resistant hash functions. No, it is not anymore.
Right? If such a question appears in a quiz...
If you're unsure, raise your hand, and if you're not satisfied, you can always file a complaint against... No, we'll try in the quiz to be as non-ambiguous as possible. Next topic is certificates. So this is a classical use of asymmetric cryptography, public key cryptography, for example, when you do a transaction over HTTPS. Then you obtain the public key, K sub X of the public site, of the site, for example, here, your bank. Then Lisa makes two samples, means draws at random two session keys, L1 and L2, one for encryption and one for computing a MAC. And will encrypt those two keys using the public key of the bank, and the public key, the bank will therefore know the two keys because they're able to decrypt it. And they will use it in this way, for example, using the secure combination that we saw before. First you encrypt, then you do the MAC of the encrypting message. So you encrypt the message and you compute a tag of the encrypted message here. That's the normal use and frequent use of asymmetric cryptography, and the one that we use every day as soon as we go to an HTTPS site, which is most of the sites today. Now, this is not entirely safe. Here is an example of, again, the man-in-the-middle attack. What has the man-in-the-middle attack done? Well, instead of giving to you the public key of the bank, the man in the middle gave their own public key. Right? You go to the website of the bank, but the man in the middle intercepts the traffic and gives you a public key, which is not the one of the bank, but is the attacker's public key. So what are you doing? Well, you give your secret numbers, you encrypt it with something that will be very easily decrypted by the bad guy. So the only thing you protected is only one attacker can attack you, but it's not so such a good guarantee. Then this guy will decrypt L1, L2, and will pretend to you to be the bank and to the bank to be you. So this guy will do similarly, will encrypt with the public key of the bank L1, L2, and will send. So for the bank, everything is the same as before. But now, of course, when you send your message, which is encrypted and signed and authenticated, then you authenticate and encrypt it with L1 and L2 that are known to this guy. So this guy can modify the some elements of the text, for example, by re-encrypting it and sending it to the bank. So we've done all that stuff, but at the end, for nothing, right? The man-in-the-middle attack is still possible. And what's the reason? Well, the core reason is that the public key here is, we have to be sure that the public key that you get is indeed the public key of the bank. Yes? But we sign the message here. This is. Exactly, but it's a chicken and egg problem because we do all this to sign messages, right? So we sign with, in order to sign, we need to have a public key. Right? We sign with our own private key, and then somebody needs to get the public key. But if the public key of the signer is put incorrectly, but you're right, this is exactly the problem, and this problem is solved by having what is called digital certificates, which use signature, so a digital certificate. I mean, since it's a chicken and egg problem for the problem of trust, I want to know whether the public key I receive comes really from the bank. So you can say, well, if someone signs this public key, someone I trust, for example, I sign for you, perhaps you trust me, I give you here at the end of the course the public key of the bank, then you know it comes from me. Now, of course, I would not like to do that because I don't want to spend my life signing keys, but that's the idea. So the idea is that we use certificates that are obtained by a certificate authority. So what is a certificate authority? It is a company or an institution. It can be a company that is doing the job for example, a public authority, like the government of this canton or the city of Lausanne. So this authority issues digital certificates. So a certificate is a piece of text, of course, digital piece of text, a string of characters, that contains two things, an identity and its public key. So for example, here is an extract of a certificate that is used when you go to your bank. It has the identity, so the identity is a string of text that says who that thing is. And it is typically it's the job of the certification authority to verify that the guy who say they are this, then they are legitimate to do so. So if you go to VeriSign, you will need to fax them or go in person there and show an extract of the Registre du Commerce du Canton de Berne, for example, and to prove that you are this company registered in this country or this canton in Switzerland. And then you say also, here is my public key. And what the certificate authority will do is sign the public key, or more precisely, it will sign the combination of the identity that is given here and the public key, and also with who I am here. And now, if I want to verify a certificate, I will verify the signature, assuming I know the public key of the certification authority. So this is typically what will be done by your browser. In fact, what the bank gives you is not only their public key, but is a certificate that contains their public key. So the certificate contains essentially the public key and the signature of the public key by a certification authority. Now the browser will verify the signature using a public key again. But which public key? Must be the public key of the certification authority, Global Sign. Now how do we get this public key? How do we solve this chicken and egg problem? How do we bootstrap trust? Well, in most browsers, it's in the browser itself. So if you buy a Mac, you have Safari in it, your Mac will come with the software of Safari, and in Safari, there are a number of public keys of certification authorities. If you have Windows, it will be in Explorer. That's it. Now, if you install a browser of your own, then you will typically first download it using the browser that comes with your computer. So if you want to use Chrome instead of Safari, you will first install Chrome using Safari, who will check the certificate and of the site that pretends to be Google from where you are downloading Chrome, for example. So you always need to bootstrap the trust, and this is done at installation time, typically, at least for, I would say, a smartphone and computers. For PMUs and things like this, there is a subtle problem here, is how do you, if you have industrial devices, how do you install the keys? So typically you install them manually as you install the software, but then you have to realize that once you have installed software in a PMU, you should lock the PMUs in a safe somewhere, because they contain public keys. So if you store them in a public place where anybody can have access to them and reinstall the software, then you can change the certificates. As we have seen this weekend, certificates have a validity time. Why? Well, because, of course, it's safe to assume that things will not be safe forever. So certificates have a validity time. And if they're invalid, then the system doesn't work, like we have experienced in the lab. Certificates can also be revoked. That means that the certification authority, Global Sign, for example, should have a list of certificates that have been stolen or tampered with. It's like for your credit card. You can view also your credit card as a certificate. If your credit cards get stolen, then a merchant, when you buy something with your credit card, the merchant should contact the credit card authority to verify that your credit card was not stolen. The same is true for a certificate. Your browser should verify that the certificates are not in a revocation list. Experience have shown that very few browsers do it very well. And this is one of the possible attacks on the internet also. Another side effect is that time becomes important. If a simple attack can be simply to change the clock, if I can force your computer to believe that we are last year, then your computer will accept a certificate that is no longer invalid, for example. So that is also one of the reasons that if your clock is wrong, probably your computer will not work, because you will not be able to go to any HTTPS site because it will find certificates that are in the future. For example, your computer will complain if your certificate has a validity time which is in the future. So that means the certificate cannot still be used. That's a classical problem that occurs when your clock is wrong. Voilà, we'll do a break and continue this discussion at 11:15. We're ready to restart. And we conclude this section on certificates by a small question on what the certificate that your browser receives from the bank should contain. And the majority answer says D, which means we should have the public key, the identity, and that's it. And that's probably correct. If we put the public key of the certification authority in the certificate, then we don't solve any problem. In fact, anybody can sign a public certificate pretending to be the signing authority, and it can be the man in the middle who's signing it. Although some certificates do contain the public key of the signing authority, it's called a self-signed certificate, but those ones are, of course, not really useful. So the public key of the certificate authority should be known out of band in your system. That's the essence of the system. This is how you build a small chain of trust, where you trust the public key of the signing authority and of a few certification authority that comes with your system because you installed it using the software that came when you bought it from the shop, for example, that then updated it, but still the updates were done using the certificates that were pre-installed. So that's the state of the art today. We need to pre-install certificates in systems, which is a weak thing. If there is any way for an attacker to tamper with those pre-installed certificates, then you can gain control of a company. This is one of the possible attacks, industrial scale attacks against companies. If you find a way, let's say your PMUs come from ABB, if you find a way to tamper with the certificates that are pre-installed on the ABB machines by attacking ABB, for example, then you will have an open door into all ABB systems. I mentioned ABB, I don't have no indication that this would apply to ABB, but there were cases in the past where the Stuxnet virus, where the Siemens company was infected, the compilers used to develop embedded systems of Siemens were infected, and you might know the story, this is how those systems were infected and could be controlled remotely by attackers. We will conclude our tour of cryptographic and security primitives by what is called forward secrecy and Diffie-Hellman. Those are the keywords here. Assume you've done all the things that are state of the art, so you use symmetric cryptography because it's fast, but you use asymmetric cryptography to create keys and a system of certificates to make sure that everything is as secure as it can be. There is still an issue that can remain. Assume you have an adversary that records all the data. That's the standard assumption we do. We always assume that all the data that are on the fly can be seen by an adversary. So this is why we encrypt everything to make sure that the only thing you can see is encrypted data, and if the encryption is secure, this is of no use. Except that if you keep them, if you're an adversary that has long-term intelligence, which is the case of modern adversaries now you have a mafia, you have a business that is in charge of recording all the things on the internet and keeping them, it has become an industry. You have the secret services of different countries that are not all friendly to your company. You might even have competitors who are trying to put you out of business or trying to have an advantage. So we might have sophisticated company that record and keep everything, right? So what did you have, for example? You don't have the secret key L of the session, but you have the Y and the Z. The Y, which is the encryption of the session key, encrypted with RSA, for example. Now, assume that 5 years after this happens, the private key that was used for this is revealed. Why could that happen? Can you imagine a reason for a private key that was used 5 years ago to become public now? Well, if you read the press, you have a CD full of contacts of a bank that was given to a foreign government. That is, of course, a rare event, but when it happens, then you can leak some of the things. So you can imagine a computer scientist working in the security division of a company for some reason. I mean, his girlfriend left him or her boyfriend left her or whoever, and then he's completely disgruntled and he wants to reveal things, right? So you cannot assume that the key will remain, all keys will remain secret forever. So it can happen that the key is revealed. A more mundane case is illiterate computer scientists dump a computer. So the server is dumped, so we send it to déchetterie. So we dump the computer, and the computer is the hard disk, and the keys are on the hard disk. So a smart attacker, if the computer is not properly encrypted, today most Macs are properly encrypted. Windows, it's an option. Most modern Windows disks are encrypted also by master key, but in Windows, it's an option. Some companies, because of backup, etc., they don't like it. So if your computer gets stolen and somebody has access to the disk, chances are that you could reveal some of the keys. Also, 15 years ago, we would use RSA with keys of size 500 bits. Now, with a key of 500 bit, and modern algorithms that have been invented, and number theory, so mathematicians work on cracking integer factorization, we can crack those keys. So we can, given the public key, we can factor and compute the private key. So very important, I think the most important take-home message is what is secure today might not be secure in the future. So it's quite possible that something that was secure 5 years ago, due to an advance in the algorithms or other mundane things I mentioned, gets stolen. What can the attacker do? Well, now you know the private key, you can replay all those messages and you can get the secret keys out. If you get, because now you can decrypt what the guy was doing here, so you can replay this, get the secret key. If you have the secret key, you can also decrypt all the messages that were encrypted with this secret key. Now, if it's PMU, okay, big deal. You can replay the PMU streams of 5 years ago. Okay, doesn't really help you. But could happen that there is something long-term secret that was exchanged here. Password, for example. Perhaps this was containing the password of the user that was encrypted and secure, but now the password of 5 years ago of this user can be revealed in this way. In fact, this is a very common attack to find passwords, which consists in combining all this, recording things until you find a crypto system that is invalid. And we know MD5, for example, is no longer considered to be collision resistant. RSA with short keys that are less than 2,000 bits are considered to be insecure. So if you wait long enough and you have a large log of records, you will find some records that were using a crypto system that is no longer valid. So you will find a number of passwords, probably. Now, do all of you change their passwords more frequently than every 5 years? Who has a password who was never changed for the past 5 years? Okay, so do change it, right? Because there might be some bad guys in the world that know your user ID and your password. Right? It might have been safe 5 years ago. Perhaps you registered on some, I don't know, even a website of Epfl that asked you for your password, and that might have been recorded somewhere, and then your password is stolen. So the concept that goes with that is called forward secrecy. Forward secrecy means that an adversary who has all the logs of encrypted messages sent in the past and the private keys used at that time should not be able to use that to decrypt the logs. So I'm not assuming the attacker knows exactly everything that the computer was doing, he just knows the messages that were exchanged here. Now the question is, can we have a way that is smarter than the way we saw here to be able to avoid this problem? There is one way, it's called Diffie-Hellman, which is not always used, in fact it's not very frequently used, but should be used as much as possible, except if you can guarantee that all passwords, for example, of all users are frequently changed. There are other reasons for asking passwords to be frequently changed, that the password stored on a machine could be stolen as well. So Diffie-Hellman key exchange is an alternative to using public key cryptography to exchange a secret key. And it works as follows. it's a bit similar to public key crypto systems, but it uses elliptic curves typically. So A and B agree on a large prime number and a generator. So what is it, a generator? A large prime number might be again a prime number of size extremely large, so large that even in a few decades we hope it will be impossible to break it. And a generator. What is a generator? A generator is, if we use number theory, is an element of the set of numbers that we manipulate that produces all elements as powers, all elements except zero. So if we use modulo n arithmetic, it's a number between n and n, between 1 and n minus 1, such that if I enumerate all the powers of G, I obtain all numbers modulo n, except 0, of course, which is never a power of anything. It turns out that from finite field theory, such a number always exists if n is a prime number. And it's true also in elliptic curve theory. In elliptic curve use more complicated constructions than the prime numbers or integers, but they use the same property. I have a set of elements called elliptic curve elements, which are mentally the same as integers or combinations of a small number of integers, and such that there is a number, an element G, such that all powers of G gives us all elements. And that's the first thing. The second thing is that this exponentiation is hard to invert. If I give you G and I ask you compute G to the power M, you do that with a polynomial time algorithm, but I give you the result. If I give you G to the M and find the M, this is difficult. This is called a discrete logarithm. In fact, if the set is well chosen, for example, if N is prime and large, the G to the power M appear to be random. They enumerate, you obtain all values of between 1 and n minus 1, but in a random order. So if, I'm giving here an example here. Assume I'm using n is 17, which is a prime number. And if I take g equal 3, there are usually multiple generators. Here is one. 3 is a generator of modulo 17 arithmetics. I'm computing here all the powers of 3 modulo 17. So 3 to the power 1 is 3, 3 to the power 2 is 9, 3 to the power 3 is 27, which modulo 17 is 10, etc. If I do them all, I see that I obtain all numbers between 1 and 17. It's magic, but it's predicted by number theory. And conversely, if I say, if I give you a number, for example 11, and ask you, 11 is g to the power how much? This how much is called the discrete logarithm of 11, discrete logarithm in this structure, modulo 17 arithmetic with generator 3. The answer is it is 7. But if you see the discrete logarithm of 15 is 6, of 16 is 8, etc., there is no apparent order and there is no norm. If you use a large prime number, there is no known method to find the discrete logarithm other than to try them all, other than the brute force approach. Yeah. So that's the first prerequisite. So we assume that we are in a set where this works. And then once you have that, you do the following. One of the two sides of the communication chooses a random number, A, and sends not A, but G to the power A. I send that to the other end. B does the same. It chooses a random number B and sends to me G to the power B. And then what I do, I compute G to the power B, the thing I have received, to the power A. Now A is secret to me. Only I know A and I keep it secret. So here it's like asymmetric cryptography, except there are two private keys now. A and B are private and are kept private by both here. So I compute, I receive G to the B. Now G to the B is public. Anybody can see it, and an attacker will see it. The attacker can see G to the B, but the attacker does not know A. because I have never revealed it. I've sent only G to the A. But I know A, so I can compute G to the power B to the power A, which is G to the power A times B. So those, my partner will do the same, though the dual will choose B and compute G to the power A B, and those two operations commute. G to the power A to B is the same as G to the B to the power A. So we both have computed the same secret L, but we have never revealed the secret, and we don't have a public key. There is nothing that we have made public to anybody other than the GA. So that is another way to exchange a secret key. Let's see on this toy example. If A chooses 7 and sends 11, of course we assume it's very hard from 11 to find 7, which is not the case here, but if you imagine you have 2,000 bits, so then it will take you a long time to find the string that corresponds to exactly 7. So I send 11, I receive 12, but I know that the log of 11 is 7, so I know my private red thing, and I compute 12 to the power 7, which is also 7 here. Similarly, the other end, my partner who has received 11, will compute 11 to the power 13 and will find 7. This 13 for me is impossible to know. I don't know that the discrete log of 12 is 13 because I don't have the computing power to do that here. So this is how Diffie-Hellman key exchange can be used. So at the end of both exchange, both parties have a shared secret, but have not transmitted anything secret. And typically, those A and B will be dropped once L is removed. So we use that to build a session key. We transmit a number of messages. And 1 hour later, we create a new session key. And so those A and B are deleted. So they are not stored anywhere. They were just the only thing that was temporarily stored is L. But if you're an attacker and you see what is on the wires, you will not see A and B. And even if you get the disk here, you will not see B because you will perhaps have the last session key, but not, you will have the last value of B, but not all the previous values that were exchanged. So this is how Diffie-Hellman works. I've explained Diffie-Hellman using discrete logarithms in integers, modulo n arithmetic. Modulo n arithmetic requires very, very large strings of bits. And today, Diffie-Hellman uses elliptic curves that, with the same size of bits, make the job of the attacker much more difficult or requires smaller integers. So if we use that to establish a session key, we will have the establishment of a secret L, and then both parties will use this secret L to as a secret shared key using symmetric cryptography. An adversary has access to the history of the messages, cannot decipher the message, even if the adversary finds the permanent key stored at the bank, because none of those things are permanent keys. In fact, there is no permanent key in this simple exchange here. So Diffie-Hellman will provide forward secrecy. At least we believe. So I will conclude with this last quiz. What should we believe, in fact? close the poll in 5 seconds. And the correct answer is C. Diffie-Hellman creates secret keys without exchanging anything secret. But of course, it is forward secure only as long as the discrete logarithm is forward secure. So if an attacker finds a way to solve the discrete logarithm problem, then he can recreate the exponents, the logarithms A and B, that were not exchanged, but that were contained in the message. If you're an omnipotent attacker, if you have infinite power, you can have this. Nonetheless, it is believed that Diffie-Hellman is better than using RSA, for example. Does A apply to RSA also? If we use RSA or any asymmetric cryptographic system to create the secret keys, does A apply? What do you think? Any volunteer to risk an answer?
No.
No? It does not apply.
Yes.
Yes, it does apply. Correct, entirely correct. So A is true for Diffie-Hellman key exchange, but is also true for hybrid cryptography using the asymmetric cryptography algorithms to exchange secret keys. So this is true also, and that's the beauty of asymmetric cryptography. Nonetheless, with asymmetric cryptography, there is still this private key, which is a secret, which is a threat. If, as long as this secret exists, if somebody can find it, then the things of the past that were secret can be no longer secret. Here we go one step beyond. There is no secret key, so we still need to secure the discrete logarithm. That can or cannot be true, we will see. I'd like to come back to this quiz we did just before the break. So there was a very smart remark done by one of you that, no, not this one. This one here. That if the ciphertexts are the same, it must be true that the plain texts are the same. And in fact, this is probably not true if we use this. It depends what happens to the initialization vector. Remember, we use a nonce to encrypt here to randomize the message. So this is true only if we use the same nonce, which is likely not to be the case. So in fact, one of the purposes of using a nonce is to make sure that when we encrypt the same message twice, we don't get the same ciphertext. So I will correct this in the online solutions. And thank you for showing that. Voilà. In fact, that's the end of this overview of security. This is, as I said, an overview. My goal here was to give you the vocabulary so that you know what is Diffie-Hellman, what is RSA, what is asymmetric cryptography, what is a tag, what is a signature. All of this, you should know them. In fact, every engineer should know them. They are part of the cyber world today. And whether you do a smart grid or a car, or you work in a chemistry company, you will use cyber systems. Your systems can't be attacked, so you will have to understand all of this. I hope also to have raised your interest to learn more, that you will have to do a bit in the lab. In the lab, we will ask you a few questions to see in practice when we use DTLS, which is one of the state-of-the-art technologies today. What of these are used in DTLS? And I hope you will understand why it is used. And perhaps some of you would like to take a full-fledged security and cryptography course, which might be another story. Voilà, thank you very much. That's all for today. See you a bit later.